Well, good morning, everyone. Come on in. Find a seat. But stop by the front, the little front desk there. There's your song notes, your sermon notes. I have more pens for you guys because the 10 I had were stolen like over the last couple months. No, actually appropriated. That's better, not stolen. So I wonder what's the best side for the ocean view? This side or that side? I guess it's all. It's kind of cloudy. That's good. So as you're coming in, I'm going to ask you guys a question. Those of you who are on time get to participate. This is good. So if you could have a superpower, what would it be? What'd you say? Flying. I don't know. So, well, our hero this morning, his superpower is he walked on water, and his name is Peter. So he didn't stand a paddle. He actually walked on water. So our superpower is knowing God. It's very cool. Psalm 1 says this, "Those who know and delight in the Lord will be like a tree firmly planted." And Psalm 46 says, "God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, God is within us and we will not fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us." So when we see God, we can't help but be overwhelmed. So please stand, take your blue song sheets, and let's sing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Spinning in heavenly dance, oh God, all that
Every anxious thought that steals my breath, it's a heavy weight upon my chest. As I lie awake and wonder what the future will hold, help me to remember that you're in control. You're my courage when I worry. What we are doing today, and we can do it every day, Father, remembering that we can rest in your provision and protection, your love and your goodness and your perfect plan for us is what we can rely on. So help us to keep our eyes fixed on you, to believe that you are greater than the battles in our minds, and to leave our troubles in your hands. Like we were singing, Father, even though I'm in the storm is not in me. And we all said amen, right? Okay, so help yourself to some candy corn. It's the season. And some chocolate. Okay. And visit for a while.
Okay, if you could find a seat. I'm going to roll along here, and I'm going to give talk to our Father for just a minute. All right, let's pray. Father, we again rejoice in being in your presence before you today, and we bow before you. We want to honor you today, and as we do every day. But Lord, we know that, you know, life faces us with challenges, and it's be easy for us to be intimidated by all kinds of fears. And so we pray that today you would give us a perspective to help us to deal with those fears, whether they be things that come in terms of financial issues, physical issues, pain, relationships, all of it. Lord, help us to be able to live boldly in you. And we pray that you'll teach us through your word this morning as we look at the example of a brother in Christ who learned some valuable lessons about dealing with fear. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. So after I graduated from college when I was living in Long Beach, I became a fan of the Los Angeles Kings hockey team. You know, I had, having grown up in Bakersfield, for 1 year there was a semi-pro hockey team in Bakersfield, which was amazing because ice couldn't live in Bakersfield. You know, it was too hot. But anyway, they had this hockey team. And my dad, who grew up in Ohio and grew up with hockey, he took us to see some games. And we thought it was the greatest thing we'd ever seen. But then it was gone. And then later, we moved to L.A. area. I was living in Long Beach. Jerry, my brother, was living up in Northridge. And we became fans of the Kings, real live professional NHL hockey, and it was great stuff. And we just went to all the games that we could. And then my brother came up with a really harebrained idea. He said, you know, hockey is so much fun to watch. Wouldn't it be great if we could play it? Yeah, that's great. And we thought that was a really good idea. There was just one problem, and that was, can't I skate? It's hard to play hockey if you can't skate. No problem, we'll learn how to skate. So we took about learning how to skate. Several friends of mine also joined in this program, friends of Jerry's. We were going to all learn how to skate. We bought hockey skates. You know, hockey skates are different than the, if you go to the rink and rent skates, the skates you'll get there are not hockey skates. They're different. So we bought our hockey skates, and we started learning how to skate. And so I remember one night in particular, I was several of my friends had went to an ice rink, and we're working on our skating. And particularly, one of the things that in skating, particularly if you want to play hockey, it's really helpful if you can stop every now and then, you know? And so you have to learn how to stop. And on hockey skates, the only way to do that is you have to do a hockey stop, which is you're skating this way and you turn your skates perpendicular to the direction you're skating and dig your edges in, which, you know, if you do it right, looks really cool, you know, when you're going fast, you stop and the spray goes up in the ice, it's all cool. But it's a little bit tricky to learn how to do that. And so this one night, I and my friends are out there, we're skating around and we're working on our, we're skating real tentatively, real slowly, trying to, you know, get the feel for the edge going in there and how to stop. And one of my buddies was starting to feel pretty confident. He thought, yeah, I'm getting this, I got this. And so he decided he's going to try it at higher speed. So he got up some speed and he goes, okay, now I'm going to stop. And he turned his skates, only he didn't quite get his edges in. And what he did was, he just kind of turned, and he went, boom, and spun around a real fast cycle, a circle, and lost his balance and went, boom, face first into the ice. Broke his nose, cut his forehead, got a concussion, was ugly. And you know what? That was the last time he ever skated. He just said, I don't ever want to do that again. It was scary, and it was painful, and he was afraid of doing that, and that was the end of hockey for him. I went on to actually learn how to skate and become a really poor hockey player. Jerry actually became a pretty good hockey player. I was poor, but I played until I was almost 60 years old. So, you know, it was cool. But my friend never got that far because he was afraid of that happening again. All of us are going to deal with fears in life. And so there's always this issue of what can help us with dealing with fear. And this morning we're going to look at the example of a brother in Christ who went was in a kind of fearful situation, and see what he did, what we can learn from him. And we're talking about Peter this morning. And so this is, as we continue studying some of the heroes of the faith, we're looking at Peter this morning. And this is from Matthew 14, beginning of verse 22. Here's what happens. Immediately, this is right after Jesus had just fed a crowd of thousands of people miraculously. It says, immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side of the lake he's talking about, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone. The boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It's I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. And Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" he said. And then when they climbed back into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, that is Jesus, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." So this incident, like I said, took place right after Jesus did this amazing thing of feeding these thousands of people. And the people responded to that situation by just deciding they wanted Jesus to be their king, their Messiah, because they were thinking, okay, he's the Messiah, he can give free food, we're going to have free food for life, this is great. Wrong focus for them. And so Jesus, I think, was bothered by all the sudden popularity for the wrong reasons, so he decided he needed a little Jesus time. So he says to the disciples, "You guys go on across the lake. I'm going to spend some time by myself, and I'll meet you on the other side," with the idea being he would walk around the northern edge of the lake and meet them on the other side. So this incident takes place, Matthew says, it's in the fourth watch of the night, which meant sometime between 3 and 6 a.m. So very late at night, dark. You could start this story with, it was a dark and stormy night, you know. Winds howling, it's dark. Waves are slamming them. And since the guys had gotten in the boat at the end of the previous day, they've basically been rowing all night. So they're tired, and they're exhausted and frustrated. You know, it's interesting that they call that body of water the Sea of Galilee, because it's just a lake. You know, it's not a sea. It's 13 miles long, 6 miles wide. So it covers about 64 square miles. Lake Tahoe, by comparison, is 22 miles long, 12 miles wide, 93 square miles, so 193 square miles. So it's three times the size of Galilee. So to row across Galilee would normally take a couple hours. But these guys have been rowing against a strong wind and resulting waves. Now, I don't know if you've ever had the experience. Lori and I have had the experience of kayaking and rowing against the wind, and discovered it's surprisingly difficult. You know, we had an occasion where we once were rowing up the Kailua River, Wailua River in Kauai, and, you know, paddling upstream was hard work and just tiring, and you make little progress, but we kept thinking it's going to be great when we, at the end of the day, we're going to go back down and it's going to be with the current, it'll be easy. What we didn't realize was in the afternoon, the wind comes up from the ocean, comes up river, and all of a sudden you're battling against the wind, and it was harder going against the wind than it was against the current. It was very frustrating. So these guys are frustrated. It's hard. They're tired. It's dark. And at that point, Jesus pulled off what I think had to be one of, if not the most bizarre miracles that he did. So they were thinking he was going to walk around the lake. They were going to get over there and wait for him to show up. But he doesn't walk around the lake. He walks across the lake. That's impossible. Well, yeah, that's kind of the point. I still, even after years of now of seeing this, it still strikes me as odd when I see people, like at the ocean, standing up on the water. You know, they're out there stand-up paddleboarding, and it's just, to me, it's kind of an odd sight. You go out there and you go, there's people standing on the ocean out there. But they're not actually standing on the water, right? They're standing on a board. What Jesus was doing was way different than that. He wasn't standing on a board or a boat. He's standing, walking on the water. You know, the Bible tells us that Jesus did a lot of miracles. You know, there are people we all know that claim, well, miracles, they aren't real. Miracles don't happen. I would simply say to that, did you happen to watch the Padre game on Tuesday night? Padres were on the verge in the ninth inning of losing a game they should have won, bases loaded, and they pulled off a triple play to beat the dreaded Dodgers and secure for themselves a postseason berth. I'm afraid miracles still happen. It was obvious. Anyway, just kidding about that. But, you know, if Jesus was who he claimed to be, we're talking about God revealing himself in human form. If he could do that, why are we going to worry about a few small miracles like walking on the water? God can reveal himself to human beings. He can do anything he wants. In this case, it's kind of a curious miracle. You know, when you think about most of the miracles that Jesus did, they were done to benefit people. He healed, you know, paralyzed people and lepers and those who were blind. And he brought back to life a little girl, and he fed thousands of people. These were all done to benefit. Walking across the lake didn't benefit anybody. There's no compassion involved in this. So it's kind of a strange miracle. You know, why? It kind of feels a little bit like a stunt, you know? Why did he do that? I think the reason for that is you have to think about the disciples of Jesus and people in general, but especially the disciples. They'd seen Jesus do some incredible things. They'd seen him turn water into wine. They'd seen him heal paralyzed people and blind people. Just amazing stuff. And they had even seen him in an earlier occasion on that same lake during a violent and potentially deadly storm just say to the storm, you know what, knock it off, and no more storm. And you would think, seeing all those things, they'd have a pretty good idea who he was. But our problem is that we have a tendency to look at that through our grid. And if we back up and look through life, look at Jesus through their grid, there are some things that might have made that not quite as easy as we think. All these guys were good Jewish men. And to them, though Jesus obviously could do some amazing things, he looked like and actually was a normal human being. I mean, he had a body just like ours and had to sleep like us, had to eat, had to, you know, do all of the things humans do, had all the limitations humans have. And so for them, good, devout Jewish men, to see a human being as divine, that's a bridge too far. For them to see a human being as somehow God revealing himself would have been abhorrent. And so they're interpreting Jesus and they're saying, clearly he has power from God that's not normal human beings, but that would probably put him in the category of being like a great prophet, like Moses. I mean, Moses parted the sea, you know, or Elijah, you know, all the amazing things that Elijah did. Jesus is probably like that. And so earlier, in that earlier incident with the storm, when Jesus calmed the storm, Matthew 8:27, need to notice their reaction to it. After that happened, it says, the men were amazed and asked, What kind of man is this? Even the winds and waves obey him. We don't know. But he's not normal, but he's a man, and that's as far we're going to go. Compare that to their response to this incident. In verse 33, it says, "Then those who were in the boat worshipped Jesus, saying, 'Truly, you are the Son of God.'" This is the first time they did that. They're doing the thing that seemed inconceivable to a devout Jewish man. They're worshiping a human being because they know now this is something divine that we're seeing. That's why Jesus did this. You know, this is an astounding trick. You know, our grandson, Wesley, he's had a bit of a breakthrough a couple of weeks ago. Wesley's 5 years old now, and his mom and dad wanted him to kind of get more water safe. And so they've been bring him over to our neighborhood. We have a neighborhood pool, and they've been giving him swimming lessons in our neighborhood pool. And their teacher they found for him has been outstanding. This guy is so positive and so encouraging. He's just an awesome guy. And he told Michael and Carissa, you know, Wesley's mom and dad, you know, there are certain barriers that kids have when it comes to swimming. One of the barriers that all kids face, it's really hard for them to get through, is putting their face in the water. Because, you know, kids inherently know, I put my face in the water, I can't breathe. That's a bad thing. So they avoid that at all costs. And Wesley avoided it religiously. I mean, he would have no part of that. And so this made, for him, jumping into the water just a no. Because he knows one thing. If you step into or jump into water, you're going to go down. And you're going to go into the water. And your face is going to go under the water. And that's scary. And it happens every time. You know, it's not like, well, sometimes you might go, the water's over your head. And you step into it, you're going under. The disciples knew that. But Jesus stepped on the water and stayed right on top of it. Didn't go under. Wesley had a breakthrough. I mentioned that because I need to finish that story. A couple weeks ago, they were over at our house and he was swimming. And all of a sudden, Wesley just jumped off into the water. And I thought, he went under. I thought, oh no, the poor kid's going to be terrified. I need to get him up. And he just popped up out of the water, had this huge grin on his face. All of a sudden, it was fine. I don't know what happened, but it was great. Anyway, bigger issue. Here's the thing. These guys lived their lives around that lake, most of them. They were fishermen. They understood water. They understood you try to step into water. If it's over your head, you're going under. But Jesus stepped on the water and stayed on top of it. And they knew there's no human being that has the power to do that. This is something divine. So what happens next is this brings us to our hero here, Peter. You know, he and the other guys, before Jesus actually, well, when Jesus shows up, they're exhausted, they're frustrated, they need sleep, they're very tired. And all of a sudden, they see this off in the mist, in the dark. What is that? Are you seeing what I'm seeing? It looks like there's a person standing on the water. What's going on? I've never seen anything like this. And so, you know, if I were in their sandals, I would be thinking, oh boy, I've lost my mind. I'm seeing things, you know. What they said, literally, the Greek text says, they said, it's a phantasma. That's the Greek word that used. So we get our word phantom from it. It's a ghost. It's an apparition of some kind. We don't know what this is, and we don't know what it means, but it can't be good. And Jesus, at that point, said to them, you know what? Don't be afraid. It's me. You don't need to worry It's your old buddy Jesus. And of course, they're probably thinking, well, that's what you'd expect a ghost to say, right? Because he's trying to fool us. So Peter wanted proof that it actually was Jesus. So he says, if it's really you, Lord, tell me to walk out on the water with you. Now, I was thinking about that request. It's kind of an unusual request, actually. I was thinking, okay, he wants Jesus to verify his identity. How's he going to do that? You know, I'm not exactly sure what they would want that would prove Jesus was who he claimed he was. You know, in an infamous incident, I once had to prove my identity to the TSA at the airport. You know, so most of you know that story. When I stupidly left my wallet and my ID at home, showed up at the airport, and then I got to prove who I am. How do you prove who you are if you don't have your ID with you? And, you know, what they did was they kind of put me aside and gave me a dunce cap to wear. No, they didn't do that. Put me aside, and they start interrogating me, asking me questions, you know. What's your name? What's your address? What's your birthday? You know, and a couple other questions. What's your wife's name? And then they started getting more difficult. What's your mother's maiden name? What's your mother's birth date? You know. Anyway, what were Peter and the disciples supposed to do? Go, okay, if it's really you, Jesus, what's your mother's maiden name? What was your first miracle? How about that? What was the nickname you gave to Simon? You know. Peter comes up with, well, if it's really you, Jesus, tell me to walk out there with you. Why would he ask that? We don't know because the scripture doesn't tell us, but here's my guess. Not long before these incidents, Jesus had actually sent the apostles out on a mission to proclaim his name to people. And they sent them out two by two. You might remember that story. And when he did that, he said, I'm going to give you the power to heal, to do what I do, and to do the miracles that I have been doing. And they did. And we're told that when they came back from that, they were just sky high. They said, it was so cool. We were able to heal people. It's awesome. Peter, I think, is thinking, okay, if it's really Jesus, and he's doing something miraculous, you know, once before, he gave us power to do the things he can do. So if it's really him, he can do that again. He can give me the power to do what he's doing. And that's why he said, okay, Jesus, it's really you. Then you tell me to do what you're doing and give me the power to come and do that, to walk out on the water with you. Jesus told Peter to get out of the boat and join him for a stroll. Verse 29 says, Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. You know, I think about that whole thing of walking on the water, you know. On a stormy night with, you know, the wind waves are battering everybody. And how did Jesus handle waves? You know, did he have to walk uphill over them or did he just walk through them? I don't know. We're not told. But Jesus did it, and now Peter is doing it, becoming the only person in history besides Jesus to walk on water. But he didn't walk for very long. As he started walking toward Jesus, Peter began noticing, it's kind of rough out here, you know. I'm walking along, and oh boy, here come some waves. And whether he's thinking he's going to walk through them or over them, he's starting to get scared and he starts thinking, I don't think I can't do this. You know, when I was in high school, we had some family friends who owned a boat and they loved to water ski. And they on three different occasions, they invited us to go water skiing with them. And they were all in three different bodies of water. They taught me how to water ski. It was on the Kings River up in the Central Valley. Learned how to ski there. And then the next time actually was at Carpinteria. And we were out in the ocean. Water skied out in the ocean. The third time, it was on Lake Ming, which is outside of Bakersfield. And this one presented some challenges. because it was summertime in Bakersfield, which meant it was 2,000 degrees. So there were a ton of people there out enjoying the lake, a lot of people in boats and water. And what that meant was the water got really rough because there's all these boats, skiers going around. And so I'm skiing around, I'm doing pretty good. But then there came a point where all of a sudden we came across a series of really big wakes. And as those were coming, I started thinking, I don't think I can get over these. I got scared. I thought, oh no. And you know, all you really need to do in that situation is hold onto the rope and let the skis take you over. But I started thinking, I got to get over this. I got to get over. Down I went. That's what happened to Peter. I got to get over these. I got to go over them. Oh, I don't think I can do this. Well, duh. It's never been about you being able to do this. You can't do this. You're only doing it because Jesus allows you and gives you the power to do it, Peter. But, oh no, Peter started thinking it's up to me. And when he did, down he went. On the way down, he did the one thing that he needed to do, and that is put his faith back in Jesus. Lord, save me! And Jesus pulled him out of the water and saved his life. Okay, weird story, so what? What does that mean to us? Well, there's some things I think we can learn from Peter in this situation. A couple of really important lessons. And the first one that I think it's easy to miss is that Peter's love for Jesus caused him to act in this situation. You know, Peter had tremendous love for Jesus. You know, the whole football team was in the boat that night. Only one of them wanted to get out of the boat and go to Jesus. It was Peter. And that was characteristic of Peter, wasn't it? Peter was always the one, always the first, to want to be with Jesus and do what Jesus wants you to do and to just honor Jesus, to love Jesus. And on Matthew 16, 13, there was that occasion where Jesus asked the disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they threw out some ideas. Oh, some say you're a prophet, some say this, some that, you know. And then Jesus asked the real question he wanted to get to. Who do you say I am? Do you remember who responded? It's Peter. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Peter, he's the one who always pipes up because he loved Jesus. Acts chapter 2, it's the day of Pentecost, and the Holy Spirit is given, and all of these amazing signs happen, and people are seeing what's going on. They're saying, wow, what's happening here? How is this happening? Do you remember who responded? Acts chapter 2, verse 14 says, then Peter stood up with the 11 and raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Peter was always the one quick to jump in because Peter loved Jesus. Can't read the gospel accounts of Jesus' life without noticing that Peter was a guy that was just all in when it came to loving and serving Jesus. And I think that's something we should learn from him. When we saw David in the Old Testament, that's the same quality we saw in him. He had a heart for God. He wanted to serve God and know God more than anything else. And Peter, same thing. These great leaders, because of their devotion to the Lord. And that's something we could admire about him. And I think most of us would say, yeah, you know what? I wish I had more of that passion for him. I want to have that. But how do I have that? Where does that come from? Well, you know, some of that is a choice. The scripture actually tells us, love God. Jesus said, love the Lord with all your heart, soul, your mind, your strength. That's a command. You can either obey it or disobey it. We have a choice. So some of it's choice. But there are some other things that can help us develop a greater love for God like Peter had. There's a incident in the Old Testament that I think points us in the direction that we need to think. And it's in Isaiah 6. And that's the occasion when the prophet Isaiah was given this vision of God on his throne. So in verse 8 in Isaiah 6, after he first sees God, there's a point where God says, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? In other words, I've got a mission. I've got a message I want to put out. Who's going to go? And Isaiah is like Peter. He pops up. He goes, ooh, ooh, me. I'll go. He can't wait to volunteer and say, yeah, send me, God. I want to go. And I think, okay, why did he respond like that? Where did that come from? And I think there's two important things you can see in that passage that caused that reaction from him. One shows up in the very first verse of the chapter. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on the throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. The point is, Isaiah saw God for who he was, or is. He saw his glory, and he went, oh, that's amazing. And when he sees God for who he is, that creates that desire to honor him, to know him, and to serve him. Writer and former pastor Mark Buchanan said, our greatest need in times of greatest need is to see the Lord. And I would expand to say our greatest need every day of our lives is to see God for who he is. The more we see God for who he is, the more we see his majesty and his power and his goodness and his patience and his grace and his kindness and his love and his justice, the more we see his holiness, the more we're going to want to love him and to honor him. So that's a big part of it. But there's something else that we also need to see in that passage, and that is that when Isaiah saw God in his glory and his holiness, the initial reaction was, uh-oh. In verse 5, he says, woe is me, I cried, I am ruined. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. I'm a man of unclean lips? Well, brush your teeth, dude, you know, and no, that's not going to solve the problem. What is he saying there? What is the thing of unclean lips? What's that mean? Well, Matthew 15, 11, Jesus said, after people, he was talking about the Pharisees who were all concerned about don't eat bacon, you know, for breakfast and that kind of thing, or what you eat. And in Matthew 15, 11, Jesus said, what goes into someone's mouth does not defile them, but what comes out of their mouth, that's what defiles them. Ah, why? Well, he says in verse 16, it's because the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart. And what's in the heart, there's where the problem is. Isaiah got it. All of a sudden, when he saw the glory and purity of God, it exposed what was in his heart. You know, I recall a time when Lori and I went to the movies. We were at the theater. And I love when you go to the movies, you get popcorn. And you just load it with that stuff they call movie popcorn butter, which I don't even want to think about what it really is. You know, it comes out of the pump thing. You can just, oh, get more in there, you know. So I love it. So put some salt in there. Oh, it's so good, you know. So movie starts. We're eating our popcorn, you know. And enjoy the movie. I don't even remember what it was. Movie ends. We come, walk out of the theater into the lobby, and I realized in the light of the lobby, there's butter stains all over my shirt. And, yeah, boy, couldn't see them in the dark. You get in the light and, oh, no, look at that, look what's there. Being exposed to the holiness and the glory of God exposed what was there in Isaiah. And he went, I'm dead. I'm so guilty. I'm so deserving of God's wrath and judgment. He's terrified. You know, have you ever had an experience where you just, something happened and you were exposed, something about you was revealed, and it was, you felt vulnerable and awful and humiliated? And, well, Isaiah's there, only he was not just humiliated, he was terrified. And what happens next is really weird. Verses 6 and 7 say, "Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar, and with it he touched my mouth and said, 'See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for.'" Isaiah knew he was as guilty as he could possibly be, and somehow the coal symbolized burning away all of the guilt. It's all taken care of. It's all done. You're forgiven forever. And he was so relieved, so happy, that when God said, "Well, now I need somebody to go with a message." "Oh, me, me. Oh, this is so cool. I see God. He's awesome. And I'm forgiven. And I don't deserve it, but I'm free." Yeah, that's what created that passion. And that's what will create the passion for us. You know, many years of ministry I've encountered often in the church, all talk about discipleship through programs. We're going to have, here are all the things you need to do and so that you can become a true disciple. And here's the thing, all the programs and the steps and all of that in the world will never create passion in the heart. What creates that passion for God is seeing God for who he is and experiencing his grace. When we are truly forgiven and we know it and we are humbled by God's kindness and love for us, that's when we begin to be passionate for him, like Peter was. So we want that passion. Let's see God for who he is. Let's remember who he is. And let's remember his grace for us, because that's what sets us free and creates that passion in our lives. The second thing I think we need to learn from Peter is that he was driven by faith, not by fear. You know, fear is an issue that all of us are going to deal with in life. Life is going to confront all of us with fears of many kinds. You know, fear of failure, fear of what other people might think of us, fear of how I might look, fear of loss, fear of pain. You know, it's interesting. An interesting thought experiment is to spend some time and think about, what would I do if I were never afraid of anything? Think I would live a little bit differently. How can we be free of fear? You know, there was a reason that none of the other disciples were going, "Hey, Jesus, can we come out there with you?" It's because it was frightening. One time in my life, I have been on a boat at night during a storm. I would much prefer not to ever repeat the experience, to be honest with you. You know, I've heard some adrenaline junkie type say, "Oh yeah, you get in a situation like that, and I feel so alive." What I felt was miserable. You know, it was trying to keep from being seasick, and it was cold, and it was wet, and it was dark, and it was scary. I just wanted it to end. And these poor guys are out there in this boat, and it's dark, and it's scary, and they got Jesus out there, and they go, "I don't know what's going on." And they're not anxious to go out there outside the boat, because I can tell you from being in the boat during the night in a storm, it's a lot better in the boat than it would have been out of the boat. Going out of the boat, no bueno. No thank you. Don't want that. It was scary for Peter. There was a point where Peter was going to have to go, "Okay, I'm going to step out on the water. Hope it holds me." It was fearful. It was very strong and very real, because stepping out of that boat would be insane. And Peter felt every ounce of that fear. And only one thing made him able to do it, and that was faith. He believed that Jesus could make him able to step on top of the water. You know, faith gave him the will to take the risk and get out of the boat. John Ortberg wrote a book that refer to this incident and title the book, "If You Want to Walk on Water, You Got to Get Out of the Boat. You Got to Take the Step." We're going to live all in, walking, pursuing God. We're going to have to get out of the boat, and it's scary at times. These days, you know, it's common to hear people say that, well, it's having faith. That's what matters. And as long as you have faith, that's what matters. That's kind of weird because that's having faith in faith. You know, it's just having, somehow the having faith is the thing that strengthens you. That's not right. What matters is what your faith is in. You know, the whole stand-up paddleboarding thing, years ago, Lori and I were on vacation, and one day we decided we wanted to go stand-up paddleboarding. And so we had done it several times before. So I had no qualms. We were going to do this. It was going to be really fun. We've done it before. It's going to be great. And particularly this was going to be really easy because the place we were going to be paddleboarding was actually inside a reef. And so it was very calm water, you know, at least that was the theory. What we failed to notice was this particular day, a large swell rolled in. Large enough that the swells were actually rolling in over the reef into what would normally be calm waters. And so, you know, I got out there confident. I had faith that I could stand up paddleboard no problem because I've done it before. We got out there and it was miserable. Because we'd get up and the swell would come in and knock us over, and another one would come in and knock us down. We'd struggle to get up and down we'd go. I had confidence. I had faith. The problem was my faith was in an object that it shouldn't have been in because I didn't have the ability to do what I had faith that I could do. What matters about faith is the object of the faith. Peter's faith was in a man he had seen rule over the wind and the waves. And it wasn't so much that Peter had strong faith, it's that he had faith in a strong Jesus, and that's the key difference. It doesn't take a lot of faith to take that first step. It just requires enough faith to take one step. And the faith that enables us to do that is in a God that we can always trust. You know, that night Peter experienced failure when he began trusting in himself. It was rather spectacular. But he believed in Jesus. And ultimately his faith in Jesus is what saved him. And the really cool thing is, though he failed for a bit, his faith in Jesus allowed him to do something no other human being has ever done or ever will do. He experienced the glory of God because he stepped out in faith. What we need is not, I've got strong faith. What we need is, I have a little faith in a God who is all-powerful, loving, holy, good, kind, merciful, graceful, wise, and righteous. A God who is at work in my world today, and I can trust in him. That's what we need. There was a man named Doug Coe. He died about 2017. He was a quiet, humble, very godly man whom God used in amazing ways. Among other things, he worked at the International Christian Leadership Center in Washington, D.C. He had a huge impact on a lot of people in D.C., in our nation's capital. He actually ended up being a key player in some critical international events like the Camp David Accords. He was integrally involved in that. He was instrumental in Chuck Colson coming to Christ and had done a lot of amazing things. But Coe told an interesting story about a man he would only identify as just a normal insurance salesman, a guy named Bob, he called him. And he said Bob put his faith in Jesus Christ, and he began meeting with Doug Coe to help grow in his faith, and he was excited about his faith. And then they were studying the scriptures. At one point, he was astounded at when he came across Jesus' promise, where Jesus said, ask whatever you will in my name and you shall receive it. And he said, is that really true? And Coe said, well, yes, but you have to keep it within the context of Scripture and its significance in the context of Scripture. So it's not just, you know, health and wealth, God will give you whatever you want. But yeah, he answers prayer. Jesus answers prayer. Bob says, is that really true? So Doug said, you know what? I'm going to make you a deal. I want you to pray for, decide that there's something you want to pray for. I want you to tell me what it is. And so Bob said, I think I want to pray for Africa. And Doug said, well, that's a little broad, you know. Can you narrow it down? And he said, well, how about if I pray for Kenya? So Doug said, okay, you know what? You pray for Kenya. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to pray for Kenya every day for 6 months. So if you will pray for Kenya every day for 6 months, if nothing unusual, nothing out of the ordinary happens in regard to Kenya in those 6 months, I will pay you $500. But if you pray every day for Kenya for 6 months and sometime in there something very unusual happens in regard to Kenya, then you pay me $500. And Bob said, okay. So he's betting on prayer. And thought, okay, I'm going to do that. So Bob starts praying, and a couple months go by and nothing happens, but he keeps praying every day, every day. And one night he goes to a dinner in Washington, D.C. As they're sitting around the table, everyone around the table, they didn't know each other. They start sharing. Well, what do you do? What do you do? And they're talking. And one woman pipes up and she says, well, I help run an orphanage in Kenya. And Bob goes, uh-oh, I'm going to lose $500, I think. And so turns out she helped run the largest orphanage in Kenya. And so Bob, who had been pretty quiet at dinner up to that point, just starts peppering this woman with questions, just firing questions at her. And after a while, she goes, I can see that you're obviously very interested in Kenya. Are you from there? Do you have relatives there? What? And he said, well, no, actually, I made a bet to pray for Kenya for 5 minutes. Anyway, so the woman said, I can see that you really care about my country. Why don't you come and visit our orphanage? And so he said, I'll do that. So he went to Kenya, and he visited this orphanage, and he was just appalled at the poverty that he experienced when he saw the place. And he couldn't get it out of his head. So when he came back to the States, still thinking about it, he began saying, I got to do something. So he began writing letters to pharmaceutical companies and calling them and describing what he had seen. And he ended up saying, you know what? I know that you guys, at the end of the year, you have unsold supplies that you just throw away. Why don't you send them to this orphanage in Kenya instead? And some of them did. $1 million worth of supplies, medical supplies, went to that orphanage. They were so overwhelmed, and they knew Bob was why that happened, that the woman that he had initially met called him up and said, Bob, we're so thankful. We want you to come back to the orphanage, and we want to throw a party to honor you. Will you come? I'll come. So he goes back to the orphanage, and because it's the largest orphanage in Kenya, the president of Kenya came to the party, and he met the president of Kenya. And the president said, you know, I'm so amazed by what you've done, Bob, and we're so thankful. He said, I'd like to take you on a tour of the capital, Nairobi. Bob said, okay. So the president of Kenya takes him on a tour of Nairobi. In the course of that, they come across a prison. He sees a group of prisoners. He says, what's the story on those prisoners? And the president said, well, those are some political prisoners. And Bob said to him, yeah, that's a bad idea. You should let those people go. You should release them. Got his tour. It was amazing. He came home. Several months later, he gets a call. It is from the United States State Department. And this person says, is your name Bob? Yeah. Have you recently been in Kenya? Yeah. Did you have a conversation with the president? Yeah. What did you say to him? I said, well, I told him there were some political prisoners that he should release. And the guy said, we have been working for years to try to get those people released, trying everything we could and have failed. But they have recently been released, and we've heard it's because of what you said. So thank you, Bob. Not long after that, the president of Kenya called Bob and asked him to come back to Kenya and spend 3 days praying with him as he made significant changes in the government there. Because Bob took one step out of the boat and prayed. And a God who is very real answered prayers in a dramatic way. Our God is very much alive. He's very powerful, very real, and he's at work in our world. And we can trust him. And that's why we don't need to be afraid of anything, because our God is with us. Let's pray. Father, what a cool story of Peter taking the step to get out of the boat and to do something that was really terrifying. And we are challenged by his faith, his love for you, his desire to do what you want him to do and to be what you want him to be. And Lord, we want to be like that. So help us to see you for who you are and your glory and your power and your majesty. Help us to remember that always. Help us to remember your grace, to live in the reality of that grace and of your forgiveness and love for us. And then, Lord, help us to trust in you every moment, to have a little faith in a great God and step out of the boat. Amen.
Well, please stand and turn to your last song. Indescribable and Containable is our Lord. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Creations reveal.
big, so we can trust him. So step out of the boat. So thanks for coming. Have a joyful week. You'll see the glory of God. Thanks for coming. When to in. Talk to you later.